When you're working with your computer and you are storing something, be it a text, a spreadsheet, photos, or videos, you would typically store that data on a hard drive that is inside your computer or attached to a USB port. What if you either had a second laptop or there were more than one user who would need to access the same files? For sure, you could swap the USB drive, but there are better solutions. In a company, there would be a central file server or network attached storage, a so-called NAS, which could be accessed from everybody over the network and where files could be shared. But NAS solutions are quite expensive and might just be a little bit overkill sometimes. There is, however, a cheaper solution. You can, in fact, turn your router into a centralized file server and hence access the files from all clients that are attached to it just by mapping a network drive. That's what today's episode will be about, adding a USB hard disk to a router and using it as a NAS. On the top of the screen, you can see luci, that is the web interface of OpenWrt. At the bottom of the screen, I have a terminal open, which I will use to show log messages from the OpenWrt instance as I do stuff. You do not have to open a terminal. You can do everything from luci. This is just to explain what happens as we do things. First, let me plug in the USB hard disk into the USB port of the router and see if the USB device as such is recognized. Yes, it is, so we can continue. We need the right driver for USB storage. Clicking on System and then Software leads me to the package management of OpenWrt. The package we need for USB storage is called KMod USB Storage. You can see there are a lot of other USB modules available for all kind of different hardware. That is definitely one of the biggest advantages of an open system such as OpenWrt. Let me install the drivers and watch the log messages as the module loads. Next, we need a driver for the file system. If you are a Windows user, then your hard disk would probably have an NTFS or VFAT file system. I will be using a native Linux file system called ext4, so I need the kmod fs ext4 driver. Again, we can see the modules load in the log messages. Let me just quickly launch fdisk in the terminal window to check the parameters of the disk. You do not have to do this. This is just purely out of curiosity. I can see the disk has one partition that is 1.8 terabytes in size. Before we can share the disk over the network, we need to mount it on the router. The mount points are available in the menu under System, Mount Points. Let us add a new mount point here. We select the right device either by UUID or by device name. I will use the device name, which is DevSDB1. Just need to tell OpenWrt where to mount it. In my case, I will use a directory /mnt/bigdata, but you can use another mount point as it suits you. Don't forget to tick the enable box. The mount point appears in the list, so we can access the context menu and mount the attached device. Watch the log reader window at the bottom as the disk gets mounted. Here we go, the disk is mounted on the specified mount point and I can see that roughly 500 gigabytes of the 1.8 terabytes are used. Now that we have the disk attached and mounted, the next step is to install the file server software. I want this file server to be Windows compatible. That means it should use the CIFS protocol and appear as a Windows file server. The software we need to use in order to achieve this is called Samba. Under OpenWrt, there are two different versions of the Samba server available. That is version 3.6 and version 4. Also, there are graphical interfaces available for luci. If I install luci app Samba 4, it will install all necessary dependencies. Cool, the install is finished and I can now access the luci Samba GUI by selecting Services and then Network Shares. In this interface, you can specify the most important parameters, such as the workgroup name, the description of the server, and of course, the shared directories. I want to keep things simple and share out the whole disk. Clicking on Add lets me specify the name of the share, I call this Big Data, and the path, that is the mount point which we have created before. For this video, I'm not too focused on security, usernames and so on, so I leave all the default values. However, I do not want the file server to be visible on the internet side, just in my LAN, so I bind it to the LAN interface only. Okay, let me check from my Windows workstation. I opened Explorer and clicked on Map Network Drive. From here, I can type in a drive name to map and the network path, which is /IP address/bigdata. Here we go. I can now see the newly mapped Z drive and all the files on it. As this is the drive which I have used to store my YouTube videos, I could now just browse to one of the videos and launch it from the network drive to see if things are working okay. Let me just open one video with VLC and here we go, everything works as expected. Checking the properties of the Z drive shows the size of the disk on the router, so I have plenty of space to store data on. An alternate way of accessing this from Windows is hitting the Windows key and R and just run /router name, which will then show a list of the available shares. I can now access the share without having to map a network drive. Let me open the same video to see if this works. All good. Perfect. This already concludes today's video. I hope you liked it. If so, please give me a like. Many thanks for watching. Stay safe, stay healthy. Bye for now.